Victory in the Cross Ministries. I am Pastor Gerald, and this is my wife, Angela. We'd like to welcome you to our service, and we will hope you will just sit back and enjoy the worship service, the wonderful preaching of Jesus Christ and Him crucified. We are a Pentecostal church, hand-clapping, foot-stopping, tongue-talking church of the living God. So sit back and rejoice with us as we worship the Lord and in spirit and in truth.
Welcome each and every one of you. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. This is the day that the Lord has made. And let us rejoice in it. And Father, we come to you today in the name of Jesus. We're asking you, dear Lord, to just move in a mighty way upon every situation that's going on. We thank you, dear Lord, for that great price that you paid on the cross. And by faith, believing in what you did and who you are at the cross, everything is finished, as you said. And we're believing a healing, dear Lord, as Sister Fran tomorrow, dear Lord, in the hospital. And God, we're believing, dear Lord, everything's going to work out for her. God, we ask you to heal her, dear Lord. Yes. We need to know what's going on, dear Lord, with her. And God, find out, dear Lord, you know what it is already. And Lord, we're asking it to be done tomorrow, dear Lord.
Yes.
And God, we're asking for others in the church on our prayer list to be healed and touched. Our Sister Dorothy needs a healing. Sister Gloria needs a healing. And Brother Bob needs a healing. And others, as the list goes on and on, dear Lord, and we ask them, we're bringing them to you. Brother and Sister Shively needs a healing. And Lord, we're asking you to intervene upon every one of them. Move in a mighty way this day, dear God, and we just come to worship you. Come to praise you, and we're believing, dear Lord, that the door is going to be open soon so we can come back together and worship you in one accord, in one mind. Lord, we just give you praise, we give you glory, and thank you again. And Lord, we take authority over this sickness again, this COVID-19, yes. And Lord, to be cast out of this country forever. And Lord, we just give you the praise, give you glory, we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. I'm so glad that Jesus lifted me. Amen. Well, I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Well, I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me. Shaking head to crown. Jesus,
Jesus delivered me. Sing it.
I'm so glad.
Thank you.
Amen. I enter to worship you only. I enter to honor my end. I enter the Holy of Holies. Thank you, Lord.
I enter through the blood of the Lamb.
I am.
for the Lord God of mine to worship Him. Wherever you are today, worship Him.
Alive. Oh, church, he's alive.
He's coming soon. Yes, He's coming soon. He's coming soon.
Side of the Father making intercession for you and I. I'm going to show you here in a little minute. He's coming back. Ready or not, He's coming back. He's coming back after His bride. Come on, church. The church, we are His bride. Prepare for the coming of the groom. He's coming back. Yes, our God reigns.
Chapter 8. Hallelujah.
And I want to start with the 31st verse, read down to 39. Hallelujah. Romans chapter 8. And let's start reading with the 31st verse. The Apostle Paul, the writer of the book of Romans, says, "What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again. Who is even at the right hand of God? Who also maketh intercession for us? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all things, these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Amen. Amen. Paul says that Jesus, here in this passage, is interceding for us in heaven. Yes. Amen. Well, no, I got excited over that one.
Amen.
Amen. Preach it, Pastor Gerald. I'm glad today that somebody is interceding for me.
Amen.
Man will fail you. Man will let you down.
Yeah,
but Jesus is interceding today for you and I.
Amen.
God has acquitted us and removed our sin and guilt. So, it is Satan, not God, who accuses us. When he does, Jesus, the advocate of our defense, stands at God's right hand to present yours and my case to God. If God gave his life for you, come on. He isn't going to turn around and condemn you. He will not withhold anything. You need to live for him.
Yes.
Come on. He has given us and all the tools. He said it is finished. What part of it is finished do we not yet understand?
Amen.
Amen. I want to talk to us just for a few moments on the Spirit assures a final victory. Amen. I said the Spirit of the living God assures us through the Word of God, amen, that we have final victory.
Amen.
Amen. Bow your heads with me. Heavenly Father, I come one more time in the name of Jesus to present and preach your Word, dear God, to your people. We thank you for the sweet Spirit that we feel in this place. And as this goes on through the airwaves, dear God, I pray that those that will be watching, that this will get a hold of them and let them know, encourage them, dear Lord, that the Holy Spirit, God, has the final answer. God has the final say of every situation. Whatever they may be facing this day, God has the final say. And the Holy Spirit assures us through your word of the final victory. And it is in Jesus. We love you this day. We give you praise and give you glory. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Paul says, what shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who could be against us? Amen. We see here two questions. Two questions. The first was, what shall we then say to these things?
It is meant to take the believer, you and I, far above the difficulties of the present time. In other words, looking to the coming day. Come on. Looking for the resurrection of the church. Come on. God's wanting to take us above our problems. Each and every one of us has got problems this day. Amen. The world's got problems with this coronavirus, and we're just almost like prisoners in our own home. But I'm not worried about that, church, because I'm looking for the coming day. I've got victory. Amen. And I'm shouting victory today because of who Jesus is.
Amen.
Amen. We are to be looking at the coming day. We are to be looking at the resurrection, when all these things will then be made right. Come on. The first question goes hand in hand with the second question. If God be for us, who can be against us? This puts everything in its proper perspective. The thought of Paul is not in a form of hypothetical condition he's talking about, as it is where a question were whether God is for us or not. It's not what he's saying. His thought is, in view of the fact that God is for us. Come on. Who is or could be against us? So as to do us no harm. That is, since God is for the saints on the other side, who can harm them? Come on. If you've got God on your side today, amen, God doesn't give us a spirit of fear. God doesn't give us any fear. Come on, church. Amen. Look to Jesus. Where your strength comes from, he will protect you. He will take care of you and I.
Amen.
The devil, what the devil meant for evil. Come on. God's going to turn this around for the good.
Amen.
The devil's on a rampage today. Coming against everyone that he can.
Yeah.
Amen. But God said, if I'm for you, son, who can be against you?
Amen.
Come on, church, get that in your spirit. Write it down on a piece of paper and put it to the closest place, the place that you always visit.
Hallelujah.
Where's that place at? The refrigerator.
Amen.
Amen. When you go to that refrigerator, you'll look at that sign and say, if God be for me, who's against me? Come on, somebody ought to get happy.
Yes.
If God who can harm you?
Amen.
Here. In fact, there are many. There are many today who are against the child of God.
Yes.
With much of the opposition, sadly and regrettably, coming from the church itself, even as it has always done. And all of this, there's one thing that really matters, and one thing alone, and that is God be for us.
Amen.
Huh? Doesn't matter what's going on in the world. It doesn't matter, amen, about this coronavirus. Yes, it's a deadly thing, but if God is for us, church, he will protect us, he will lead us, and he will guide us. That's the only thing that matters today.
Right.
Come on, Sister Meyer, agree with me. I know you are. If God is for us, who can be against us?
Right.
Amen. If the whole world is for us, God isn't.
Right. Come on. Right. Come on.
Then nothing is going to work.
Right.
Huh? On the other hand, if the whole world is against us, and God is for us, it will turn out right.
Amen.
Come on. And I know that I know that I know he's for me today and he's on my side. So Paul said, what shall we say to these things? Don't worry about it. Come on. Look to the coming of the Lord. Look to the, come on, church. He's coming soon. As we sang our little chorus, he's coming soon. Ready or not, the Lord's coming. He's about ready to split the eastern sky. He's coming back after his church. We are the church, not the building. The building will stay here decayed and burn up. But the Lord's coming back after his bride. We are his bride.
Amen.
Paul says he, in verse 32, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all. how shall he not with him also freely give us all things?
Amen.
We see the great gift of God here, the Lord Jesus Christ. The idea is that God did not treat his son gentle, or near did he spare him. He gave what? God gave heaven's best.
Yes.
Amen. I said, God gave us the heaven's best that he had. The ideal is that there was never any question that love would do this thing, because love must redeem. Amen. At least if it is possible, but that the tremendous cost and the tremendous price was ever before God. And this which he did, gave his only begotten Son. He delivered him up, as the scripture says, for us, what? All.
Amen.
Meaning, that concerns the whole mankind, humanity of mankind, everyone, not just a select or predestined few, but it was for everyone. Yes. That's you and me.
Amen.
He said, how shall he not with him also freely give what? Give us all things. All things lays bare before the believer the tremendous price paid for our redemption. The ideal is he saved us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Is there anyone in here or watching? Are you saved today?
Yes.
He saved us. Come on, church. He saved us. How can we think that he is going to allow us to be overcome by the evil one? And I speak of those who truly want to live for God. If God's for me, who can be against me? Somebody ought to shout today. Because God said, how shall he? The word of God says, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? This does not mean that God will keep one against their will. Come on. But it does mean that irrespective of what comes or goes, those who want to live for God, irrespective of the opposition, need not fear.
Yeah.
Come on.
Thank you, Jesus.
I have no fear today because I know who's on my side.
Amen.
If the Lord did not did what he did respecting our salvation, then one can be certain that he will do whatever it takes to keep that one, keep for which so much has been paid. If God, come on, church, if he paid on the cross for your and my redemption, guess what? By faith, he'll make sure you and I will take it, make it to heaven.
Yeah.
In other words, God gives us all things.
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
Not because we deserve them. You don't deserve it, and I surely don't deserve it. But God gives us all things. Amen. Not because we deserve it, when in reality we deserve the very opposite. He does it because of what? His love. Because he loved us. And his grace. In other words, it's not done because of any merit that we deserve or done. Nor is it expecting anything in return. What God did for us was a gift. And I don't know about you, I love gifts. Are you hearing me? Amen. Jesus gave your pastor the greatest gift. God did. He gave his only begotten Son. Amen. And he gave it to you and I, all humanity.
Amen.
And the Holy Spirit is telling us this day, amen, that we've got victory. Yes. We got victory, church. No matter what's going on in the world today, I got victory.
Yes.
If he should come today, it's goodbye world, it's hello heaven.
Amen.
We got victory today because of that gift that was given to us. He said, who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifies. In other words, who shall pronounce those guilty whom God pronounces righteous.
Amen.
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 Hallelujah! Who shall pronounce us guilty, church, if God has given us His righteousness? This means that every single sin by the trusting believer which has ever been committed has been washed away by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And because of one faith in that blood, shed blood. Amen. Amen. Come on. As someone has said, the Christian has no past. But Satan has no future.
Amen.
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 It is an, now, let me help you. It is an insult. It's an insult for a believer to bring up the sins of another.
Yes.
Or for the believer to drag out his own sins again.
Amen.
Huh? Which the Lord has already forgiven.
Amen.
It is God that justifies.
Yes.
Huh? Means that no one, not even Satan, or his evil angels, dare question or deny God's great plan of justification.
Amen.
Huh? Come on, church. You have no past.
Yes.
Amen. Come on. Come on. Amen. And Satan has no future.
Amen.
Because Jesus has already defeated him at the cross. Paul says in verse 34, who is it that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again. Who is then, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us? Now, the only one who dares to condemn the child of God, especially considering what Jesus has done for him and the price in which he paid, is Satan and his followers. Because the Bible says in Revelation 12 and 10, it labels Satan as what? Satan as the accuser of the brethren.
Mm-hmm.
He said, who is he that condemneth? Who is he that condemneth? Well, I remember reading the scripture in Romans 8:1 says, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah!
Amen.
Somebody ought to shout today, there's now no condemnation. So the devil can do, he can accuse me of everything he wants to. But God is making intercession. Jesus is making intercession in heaven for you and I. And he said, no, no, no! Hallelujah. If God has accepted the sacrifice of his only son and proven it by raising him from the dead, whom he did, then who are we, or anyone else for that matter, to question such by condemning those who have placed their trust and faith in him?
Amen.
Huh?
Yes.
When Jesus ascended, he was then given his rightful place at the throne of God. It is at his Father's right hand. This speaks of power and it speaks of authority.
Yes.
Actually, Jesus said after his resurrection in Matthew 28:18, Jesus said this. He said, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth.
Yes.
So he's got all the power. I said he's got all the
yes.
power. Amen. He said, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or pearl, or sword? The believer's love for Christ, this is the what it is. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? There are seven weapons listed here that may disfigure, deform, degrade the believer. Christ will still love, come on, and prize him. Satan uses these weapons right here to try to separate us from the love of Christ. Not so much regarding the Lord loving us, for the enemy knows that that is impossible. However, he does not take the mistaken ideal that these foes will weaken our love for God. Satan wants, come on church, what shall separate us from the love of God? Shall tribulations? Satan's going to throw it at us. Yeah. Or distress? Satan's going to throw it at you. Persecution? Satan's going to throw it at you. Famine? Satan's going to throw it at nakedness, peril, sore. Satan's going to do everything within his power to make us walk away from God. But Paul says, who shall separate us? Come on, church. He said in verse 36, as it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Now, the Lord allows tribulation for two purposes. To expose the leaven in our lives. Hello? And two, to draw us nearer to Him. It is sad that believers need such chastisement. But guess what? Often we do. Huh? I don't see no halos in this church. Come on. I don't see no perfect people in this church. Amen. I'm perfect in God's eyes. But come on. I still will make mistakes. Come on, church. Are you hearing me? God wants to draw us closer. He wants to chastise us. The scripture says we are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Proclaims a great truth that we should learn. When we come to Christ, our life ceases to be our own.
Amen.
You are bought with a price. You do not own yourself. Come on. It then becoming the property and the possession of our Lord. He owns you. And at that moment, we give up our lives, which is exactly what Jesus told us to do. Jesus said in Matthew 16:25, for whosoever save his life shall lose it. And whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. One of the great problems of the modern believer is that he is attempting, and I might add, to build a paradise out of this present life that he's living in. Which makes him not too desirous of the one to come. If one is to notice the attitude of the early church, if you read and study, their hearts were on things above. And I'm afraid that presently, today that we're living in, too many of us has our things on things below. That's where our heart is. While the believer has a great work at this present time to do, and while that work is of extreme importance, still we must ever know and realize that the sons of God have not yet been manifested. And this will happen only when Jesus comes. Paul said in verse 37, nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through Him that loved us. Being conquerors means that such has never stopped the true church of God. And such will never be successful in that effort. Will never be successful in that effort. More than conquerors means to conquer. To carry off the victory. Come off victorious. Is there anybody in here today that's got victorious? Amen. You got victory. I got victory. I'm shouting. I'm on my way to heaven. And I'm shouting victory. Jesus allowed these things to come to pass. Not to destroy, but rather the very opposite. The conquering carries the ideal. Not so much of deliverance from these things, but rather that we did not allow these adversities to dull our testimony, but rather to sharpen our testimony. Look what the Lord has done.
Yes.
Amen? And he said in verses 38 and 39, as I get ready to close, Paul says, "For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Through all of this, church, there's a guarantee. What is that guarantee? Which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
Refers to everything we have today. Everything we have been given. Every privilege and blessing which has come our way. Our salvation, our baptism with the Holy Spirit, our eternal life, our redemption in totality. All, and he means all. Being in and through, of and by the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the manifestation of the Father. Amen. And in him are all things. He is life. He is salvation. He is grace. He is mercy. He is compassion. And he is the resurrection. He is our Savior today. And will be our judge tomorrow. Remember what Paul said. Remember it greatly. Paul said, "I am persuaded." Meaning nothing. And I mean nothing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Come on. I'm persuaded today, Brother Tim, no matter what is coming our way, no matter what is going on today, nothing is going to separate me from the love of Christ. My brother don't know it's not going to hinder me. If people don't want to come back to church, and it's not going to hinder me. If people want to backslide on the Lord, it's not going to hinder me. I want my way to heaven, and the journey gets sweeter and sweeter every day. I'm walking with Jesus, yes. Talking with Jesus, yes. All along the way.
Yes. Amen.
Amen. I'm persuaded today, no matter what's going on in the world, no matter who's accusing you, who's trying to destroy you, if God be for me, who can be against me?
Yes.
Church, remember that. You're born again, Christians. Today, believers, raise your head back up and say, "I'm going on for Jesus just the same. I'm persuaded nothing's going to destroy me. Nothing's going to tear me down. Nothing's going to separate me from the love of Christ." Amen. Why? Because Jesus paid it all. And God has the final say. I said, God has the final say. No matter what's going on, trust in him. Because the Spirit assures us victory. Huh? I said the Spirit assures us victory. And I got victory today because of what Jesus did at the cross.
Well, we pray that you truly enjoyed that worship service and the wonderful preaching that we bring to you, Jesus Christ and him crucified. The message of the cross. But I'd like to ask you a question. If there's any doubt at all in yourself, whether you would die today that you could would meet Jesus in heaven, I would like to say this little sinner prayer with you and have you repeat it with me today, if you would. It's just words, but if you will say it and mean it from your heart, you will have no doubt after you say this. So just say this with me this today, if you would, please. Repeat it after me. Dear God in heaven, I come to you today asking you to forgive me of all my sins. I believe Jesus suffered and died and rose again for all. I am accepting Jesus Christ into my heart to cleanse me and make me whole. And now, by faith, I believe I am saved. Amen. If you said that little simple little prayer, hey, angels in heaven today are rejoicing. But we would like to let you know that if you have any prayer requests at all, that you can go onto our website, victoryinthecross.org, and go to the place where it says prayer request. Or if you have anything at all you'd like for us to pray about or you want to share with us, go on there and we will definitely find it and read it and we'll pray about it with you. So again, I pray that you enjoyed this and we hope to see you again the next time we come back to you. God bless you and thank you very much.